Hey everybody, Brian Loans here. It is another episode of NHRA Shop Talk, the pre-Christmas edition. This is our last episode of the 2020 year, and we're talking about centrifugal superchargers today. Joined as always by my right-hand man, Alan Reinhardt. Alan, how you doing?
Hey Brian, I'm doing great. It's a beautiful day out here in Arizona right now, and getting ready for my Christmas tradition here at Wild West Engineering. But what is that behind you?
Ooh, this is real horsepower right here. This is a 8BA Ford flathead cylinder head that I have acquired for a project I'm working on here at home. Those of you that checked out our little preview video on Twitter saw my son and I wrenching on my tractor that I have in the shop right now, and these cylinder heads will go on a flathead V8 that'll go in the tractor. So real horsepower, Alan, a whole 100 of them when I'm done.
Real horsepower, huh? Let me just momentarily. Real horsepower. Real horsepower. That's an Alan Johnson Stage 7 nitro head. That's real horsepower.
Listen, man, the days of putting valves in the cylinder heads are numbered, man. Valves in the block is where it's at. The third member of our show today is going to be Lance Keck. Lance works for Vortec Superchargers. Vortec, the sponsor of the NHRA's Top Dragster and Top Sportsman program, and an expert in the world of centrifugal supercharging, which is a topic for today's show. Lance, how you doing, man?
Great. Thanks for having me on, guys.
This is going to be great. We're going to go through some of the We're going to go through some of the technology, going to go through some of the reasons why racers have made the switch. A lot of racers have made the switch to centrifugal superchargers. And remember, if you have questions for us, make sure you're watching on Facebook. If you're watching on NHRA's YouTube page or NHRA.com, that's fantastic. But if you want to ask questions and interact with Alan and I, or specifically ask technical questions of Lance, we'll field those questions and send them into the chat here. So make sure you're watching on Facebook to get that done. Go ahead, Alan.
I was just going to say, let's start, as always, with our historical perspective, because Brian Loans always goes back to, well, the first time they used these was when Moses was racing somebody across the Sahara. And even though centrifugal superchargers have certainly found a great home in NHRA over the past couple of years, Top Dragster, Top Sportsman especially, but they've been around like forever and ever, Brian.
Yeah, they're... Yeah, well, here you go. So they were patented in the late 1800s over in Europe. The first real practical application was in 1902. Louis Renault, of course, Renault Automobiles, a giant global corporation today. But Louis Renault was one of the brothers that founded the company. And he was really the guy that had the first workable one on a performance car back in 1902, if you could even call a car a performance car from that era. We move forward through the teens and the 20s and the 30s, and these are found on race cars all over the place. Indianapolis cars, guys like Harry Miller, the very famous race car engineer, had supercharged versions of his engines. 1924, Duesenberg wins the Indianapolis 500 with a centrifugally supercharged engine. Then we go to World War II. Centrifugal superchargers are used on radial engines. They're used on big V-style piston engines. They're used in conjunction with turbochargers in some applications. And then, of course, we work our way into the world of drag racing in the 60s. Check this photo out. This is a picture from the early 1960s, and this is a gas dragster that is using what is actually an industrial air mover off of an airplane to force feed the engine. I talked to some guys when I found this photo ages ago, and Gail Banks remembered this car and said that it was actually kind of a military surplus item the guy got a hold of, and it was a fairly short-lived experiment. But as you can see, that giant pancake-style supercharger or air mover that's using to supercharge the Hemi. We move on to this next cool photo, and this is a little bit more modern. It's still kind of crude, but you see a pair of centrifugal superchargers feeding a wedge engine here, which I believe is a Cadillac, and a very old dragster. So centrifugal supercharging in drag racing has been around a long time, but Alan, you and I have seen it with our very eyes. Over the last several years, the popularity of centrifugal superchargers in Top Sportsman and Top Dragster has exploded.
Yeah, I mean, they make very solid, consistent horsepower. One of the things that guys like about the centrifugal-style superchargers is literally there's no maintenance. You put it on, you set it up, you got nothing to do. If you've got a nitrous car, you're going to have to refill the bottle regularly, like after every pass in some cases, every couple of passes in some cases. But if you've got a centrifugal-style supercharger, and I happen to have a ProCharger D2 model sitting on the bench here, once that thing is on and once it's set, there are some adjustments that you can make if you need to adjust power level or weather changes. But basically, once it's on and ready to go, you're ready to go. You get in, you push a button, you start the car, and zero maintenance. And that makes them very racer friendly.
So Lance, you've been around these centrifugal superchargers for a long time in your career in the aftermarket. And one of the questions I have for you is, this style of supercharging has been incredibly popular in the heads-up style of drag racing, whether we're talking kind of NMRA, NMCA style racing forever. But it took a while for NHRA sportsman racers almost to discover it. What was the kind of turning point as far as these machines or these blowers becoming so popular in top sportsman, top dragster, and why do the racers love them so much?
The consistency, I think, lack of maintenance is another. We find that with some of the cars, they can pick their consistency up quite a bit. Also, the power to drive them tends to be a bit less in some of these applications, so they gain some free horsepower, if you want to call it that. So
let's talk a little bit about heat mitigation on these, because when we talk about a roots blower or a screw blower that's sitting directly on top of an engine, we know that those make heat. They heat up the charge going into the engine. Let's talk about the big differences in terms of how a centrifugal is working versus a roots or a screw that's on top of the engine with regard to heat.
Yeah, heat is a byproduct of compressing air. You're always going to incur some heat increase. The design of the impeller and the volute collector, that determines the efficiency of the unit. And, you know, we really try to stay 70 to 75% efficient. And therein lies a lot of the heat mitigation, is just by increasing the efficiency of the compressor stage.
Lance, you talk about the efficiency, and I'm sorry, Brian. One of the things about these, it really is, I mean, it's obviously a very precision manufactured unit, but it really is fairly simple. I mean, you've got a fan running inside, you know, the compressor side here, inside the turbine housing, a gear drive on the back. It runs much, much faster than engine speed. But as far as the mechanics to make this operate, it really is a fairly simple unit, right?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. I mean, you've got a gearbox that steps the impeller speed up, it's all fairly straightforward until you really get into the fine details of increasing efficiency and making the gearbox portion of it live with those kind of speeds.
No, Lance, one of the things I think is interesting, when we look at a lot of the centrifugally supercharged cars out there that are running, we see most of them in drag racing running a blow-through style carburetor. There are some guys using fuel injection, but a lot of them are using a blow-through style carburetor, whereas if we're talking about turbocharge applications, you see only fuel injection at this point. There is virtually nobody out there trying to run turbos through a carburetor anymore. Let's talk a little bit about that aspect of why a centrifugal supercharger is more friendly to doing that than say a turbocharged setup.
The turbocharged setup really needs electronics to make them run and perform to their limits. You know, bump boxes, all that kind of stuff. It really makes it where the turbo systems need to have the electronics. Centrifugals, on the other hand, that are blow through. You can really get away with far, far simpler management systems.
We talked a little bit about last week about the turbochargers, and when they bring them up on the starting line, when they're spooling them up, there's a lot of manipulation going on with both the fuel mixture and the ignition timing in order to get the exhaust velocity to get the boost up so that the turbocharger is ready to go when you let go of the button or leave the starting line. With one of these, because it's mechanical, if the engine RPM is up, the boost is up, it's ready to go. And that's why you'll see the cars that utilize a centrifugal stage in an idle, set the trans brake, and then it's just a matter of planting your foot. You don't have anything else to worry about from a mechanical side, right?
Correct, and far, far easier to drive, which adds to consistency. So getting away from having to, it just makes the car far, far easier to drive, easier to control. You can start playing with rear gear, torque converter, that kind of stuff to get the car to really perform in the first part of the track.
Yeah, that's really interesting. And to Alan's point, yeah, it's a totally different program in terms of watching those different cars stage and certainly the whole kind of theatrics that goes on at the starting line to get one work versus the other. One of the things that's always interesting to me is when we talk about a roots versus, say, a centrifugal, how and where they're making boost and what the two kind of ramps look like. Because my understanding is, immediately down low, the roots or the screw is going to have a little bit of an advantage. But as we talk about the car going down the racetrack, it's far more linear. And at some point, the roots screw combination kind of runs out of steam, but becomes way less efficient than the centrifugal does. So let's talk a little bit about how a centrifugal supercharger is working going down the racetrack in terms of providing the engine boost versus a traditional roots blower.
Yeah, as you said, a root style blower, they'll be at full boost probably within, 0.5 to 0.8 seconds. A good centrifugal that is matched properly and it is efficient, you pick up really aggressive performance characteristics the more efficient the compressor stage becomes. So we can hit near peak boost numbers within 0.5 to 0.6 seconds. So a centrifugal can hit those early track numbers from a boost perspective. The one thing about a centrifugal does over a positive displacement is it does have the ability to continue to increase the speed of the impeller as it goes down the racetrack, which in turn, ingests more air and more boost. So,
when you talk about the speed of the impeller, let's talk about how fast. I mean, those things are really singing. This is a D2, which is a couple of years old Procharger design, and I don't know. Can you see the impeller down inside there? If you watch this, I'm going to turn the drive pulley, which is on the back of it, one revolution. And in this particular case, the gear drive, the overdrive on that is 0.444. For every one revolution that the belt turns the pulley on the back, this is turning almost 4.5 times. And then you also have got a lot of overdrive when you're talking about that being the pulley on the crankshaft and this being the pulley on the blower. I mean, you can run them, I don't know, as much as what, 1.6, 1.7 over? In some of these things, the combination, the impeller inside here is running maybe as much as 7,500 or 8 times engine speed. And just to put that in perspective, if you're idling at 1,000 RPM, the impeller is turning 8,000 RPM. And those things really get to singing when they head down the racetrack.
Oh yeah. Yeah, you have to bring in bearings and all there, but typically anywhere from 65,000 to 75,000 impeller speed is what you're likely to see going down the racetrack.
So that's really incredible.
Yeah. So our particular gearbox for these units is 4.2 to 1. So very close to the other unit you're talking about.
So before we go into looking at some photos of the internal parts, one of these things, Lance, I have one more question. And the V30 is the unit we're going to be looking at. It's the unit that we find on most of the top sportsmen and top dragster racers that are running a Vortec centrifugal supercharger. What has allowed a company like Vortec to expand these things? Because really what we've seen over the years is we've seen the centrifugal blowers grow in size, which means they grow in volume, which means they grow in the amount of power that they can feed. Has it been better materials, better or the ability to be more finite in machining? I mean, what has allowed the expansion of these units to really support mega horsepower?
Really the software that's used in development of the impeller the compressor stage. The software has really become unbelievably powerful. We can really see if a design is going to be worth the effort to go through and do all the CAD work and then right down to the machining process. So the development software that we use to create the impeller profiles is for us, that's what's really made us jump leaps and bounds.
No, it's great. And so let's start taking a look at some photos here. Rob, we're going to roll through some photos, and Lance, just kind of walk us through what you're seeing and what we're looking at here, starting with this guy.
This is a V30 123. This is something like what you would see on a top dragster or a top sportsman car. This is a little bit of the internals. If you see on the outside of the impeller is located on the inside. That's a feature that we have been in development with, where we can really hone in on some of the power characteristics that the blower represents. Just another picture of the gearbox and the one piece that you see sticking out of the end of it, that is the impeller shaft. Again, gearbox, this is the input side. Input again, and same. So these are really, this is some of the
internals. I'm sorry, you say the output of yours is 4.2, that the compressor actually runs 4.2 times faster than the input shaft, correct?
Correct, it does, yes. These are some of the internal components. We have the large gear, which is the input, along with the impeller shaft and some of the other components.
This is a good look here. Yeah, I'm really interested in talking about this because we're looking at an LS motor here, and instead of the typical kind of side slinger design, we're looking at really what a lot of people have gone to with this the supercharger mounted up front. So talk me through what we're looking at here, Lance.
This is a LS-based race bracket that we've designed for top dragster and top sportsman. Some of the chassis that the top dragster and top sportsman use, they won't allow the use of a gear-driven type drive system, so this moves the blower up to a more manageable location in the vehicle. Another side profile of it uses a 50 millimeter 8 millimeter toothed type drive belt. Another view from the top. This could be adapted to run in a street car if one desired to do so.
What's the advantage or disadvantage to running directly off the front of the crankshaft versus having a belt drive? Is there one, or is it just a matter of ease of location for the unit?
Ease of location. Once you start getting into the really, really large superchargers, the amount of power it takes to drive the unit becomes significant enough that you start to have reliability issues with the drive belt, and that's where the gear drive comes into play in those applications.
How difficult would it be to make an overdrive change with the gear drive based on the belt drive? Rob, if you can come back to me for just a second. With the belt drive, like the unit that I've got here on the bench, this is exactly the belt you were talking about. That's a 50 millimeter, 8 millimeter yes. cog belt. And obviously, you know, if you want to make an overdrive change, maybe the car's running a little too quick, a little too slow, maybe the weather's changing. It'd be a matter of loosen the belt up, take the pulley off the top of the blower, change to a different pulley on the top of the blower. You can do that fairly quickly. How involved is it if you need to make an overdrive change with a gear drive with the blower mounted directly on the front of the motor?
It's fairly involved. You'd need to take the supercharger off and then disassemble the gear drive unit itself, and then you'd be able to physically move the gears and replace them with a different step-up ratio. So it is quite a bit more involved.
Sounds like then that's a decision that you're going to look at the weather forecast. You're going to try to get set up for the weekend before you show up at a racetrack, because you're obviously not going to do it between rounds, right?
Typically, yes. Yeah. Yeah. Most of the guys that are running. most of the guys that are running gear drives have really honed their combinations, so they've got a pretty good handle on what the gear set might be.
So we've had a couple of questions come in. Curtis Thomas asked, what are the benefits of veined versus unveined diffuser? If you can talk a little bit about that, Lance, veined versus unveined diffuser.
The veined diffuser, as you saw earlier, it narrows the compressor. If you were looking at a compressor map, it narrows the operating range so that we can, once we've spent some time on an engine dyno with a particular combination, we can determine what the airflow characteristics might need to be for that vane diffuser. It's really a specialized type of piece that's in there, and we're just starting to break the envelope of what possibilities are with using something like that.
You know, interesting, Brian, when I saw that, the first thing I thought was, and we talked a couple weeks ago about torque converters, the first thing I thought was a stator. Yeah. You know, you're basically fine-tuning the direction in a torque converter to where the fluid is going, but here you're fine-tuning the direction, the velocity of the air coming out of the compressor going into the engine. But that's the first thing I thought when I saw that. That's like the stator of a centrifugal supercharger.
It is, and there is as much complexity to it. The angle of the blade, the shape of the blade, the number of the blade, all of that comes into play when we're looking at something like this.
It looks really simple and makes a big difference.
Oh, it's difficult.
Yeah, and I think it goes back. It goes back to what we seem to always kind of fall back on these discussions, where, you know, this is something that's existed for 100 years, and yet we still discover new things about it, you know, by the week, by the month, by the whatever. It's a pretty amazing thing that there is still refinement and still more kind of efficiency to be found in these things. And I guess a question for you, Lance, what are the things that kind of surprises you about where centrifugal superchargers are now versus where they were even 10 years ago?
Oh, I'm amazed at the performance levels they can achieve. 10 years ago, I would have never thought that we would see 35, 36, 3700 horsepower out of these units. I'm glad to see it. I didn't expect it to happen this fast. But our technology is moving along leaps and bounds, so that certainly helps.
We had a question come in that said, the question, would there ever be an electrically driven version of a centrifugal supercharger out there, or is it just kind of too inefficient to do it that way?
Another part of Vortec, the industrial side, we provide electrical-type supercharging systems for a number of companies that are involved in balloon flight. So we're already in that front with the electrical supercharging.
Balloon flight? Was that be like for inflating the balloon or for something else?
It's used for navigation. There's an inner bladder. Some of the stuff I can't talk about,
we won't tell anybody. Brian and I can keep a secret like nobody you've ever seen.
I thought so. It's used for navigation, so that we can raise the balloon and lower it to move it through the atmosphere with the different wind currents.
Very cool.
Yeah.
You know, obviously, you know, one of the things that people love about power adders in drag racing is that the ones the centrifugal blowers we see making 36, 3700 horsepower in a car also translates directly to the guy who may have a street version or a street driven, car that has a Vortec on it, obviously a much smaller unit. But I want to talk a little bit about the transference of technology up or down with these centrifugal superchargers, because it would seem to me that I think you probably learn things from the streetcar side that can translate up, and you certainly learn things from the race car side that can translate back down to the streetcar side. So let's talk a little bit about that give and take.
Some of the things we learned from the racing side of things that trickles into our street stuff is compressor design, for one. And then gearbox and bearing selection. You really can't get in a more violent world than in drag racing. And it really puts all the systems at a strain. So we really pick up a lot of information from the racing world in regards to bearing design and also compressor design. The street going the other direction, boy, the street guys are pushing the envelope. You know, it's not uncommon now to see 1,000 horsepower cars. And along with that, they need the airflow characteristics to achieve that. So kind of goes back and forth. We designed some things for the street and they work so well that they move right into the drag racing world.
What other, you mentioned the air balloons, what other types of things, I mean, I don't want to go into like your black magic, dark secret stuff, but what other types of things does this technology relate to?
Well, quite a bit, actually. On the industrial side of Vortec, we do air management for canning plants as dry off. Where the cans flow through, we blow air across the top of them to blow the water off or whatever cleaning agent it might be. We move solid products and some feed type plants. So it just runs the gamut.
I learned something today, Lone.
Yeah, that's pretty neat. it's pretty awesome. I mean, the performance side of things is one thing. The industrial side is wholly another, and it's really cool. I mean, it's a neat kind of translation back and forth. And I guess, Lance, one last question I have for you is, when we look at a guy like Danny Nelson, 2019 Vortec Superchargers top dragster world champ, ran your product on the race car, is a good evangelist for you guys. You know, he loves that thing and he loves what it's done for his race car. Talk a little bit about that. I mean, obviously, you know, it's one thing to have a lot of product out there, but when you actually have people winning world championships with them, that really is kind of the tail of the tape, right?
Oh, it is, absolutely. Danny Nelson, what a great guy. He put one of our units on it several years ago and has just never turned back. The one thing we do a little differently than some companies is we really match the blower to the engine combination. I think some of that has helped Danny. The other thing is Danny's just a really good, smart racer. And we're happy to have him on our team.
I have one more question for you, Lance. I'm curious. I mean, we've talked obviously about the racing side of things and where we see these things in NHRA and in competition. But for a guy who's got a high-performance street car, how big a deal is it? How many options are there to put a centrifugal, you know, on a late model Mustang, on a late model car, or even on an early model for that matter? How big a deal is it to be able to get a kit, install it, get going, get ready to race, and increase your horsepower level on the street?
It's quite easy, actually. We design the systems for the average guy in mind. We really want them to have the ability to... we give the average guy that kind of knows his tools and can work in the garage, and they can do it over a weekend.
So you're saying if you could sell me a system for a Mustang, I could bring it into my shop on Saturday morning and by Sunday afternoon be test driving it. Brian could roll it into his shop on Saturday morning and maybe by Christmas 2024 be trying to fit the belt.
Yes, that is capability.
Sorry, Lone.
All right. Yeah, he's smart, Alec. We got another question came in, Lance. This is actually a good one, unlike anything Reinhardt has to say. He asks, for a street strip setup, how much does the carb with a wet manifold help with detonation versus multi-point fuel injection? He's talking about a 93-octane fuel combination, 8 to 10 pounds of boost is what he would like to run. So again, how much does a carb with a wet manifold help with detonation versus multi-point fuel injection?
It has the ability to help quite a bit. You're getting some density changes from the fuel. Typically, the fuel is several degrees degrees less than what ambient is. So you pick up some cooling effect, and then the increased density also helps.
One of the other things, Brian, one thing we didn't talk about that I think we ought to at least touch on, because if you use a centrifugal style supercharger, this thing's getting all the air it can get. And as long as that compressor is spinning, it's creating boost. And as Brian mentioned, the vast majority of the teams that are using these are using in a blow-through design where it blows through a carburetor or even if it's a throttle body. But when you close the butterflies, when you take your foot off the throttle, you have got a whole lot of boost that's piling up against those blades, as opposed to, well, let's just say on a nitro car, for instance, because everybody's familiar with those, the butterflies are on top of the blower. When the driver takes his foot off the gas, it closes the butterflies and it shuts the air off going into the compressor. But with one of these, they'll have a tendency to spike the boost, and that's where you need something like this. We saw when you saw the shot of the Vortec being mounted on the front of the LS, it had a couple of pop-off valves. But what this does is relieves the pressure on the compressor side between the compressor and the manifold, so it doesn't just blow the carburetor back open or blow the throttle body back open, and you are able to close the throttle. And that's another piece of technology that's really allowed the boost to go up, the performance to go up, but you still be able to drive these cars around. Is that correct? Is that incorrect? Tell me I'm wrong, Lance. Lungs loves when I'm wrong. Twice a year, but he loves this one.
No, you are exactly correct. And depending on the application, determines what the size of the valve might need to be. In a pro mod application, we're trying to get rid of over 5,000 CFM and over, 55 pounds of boost pressure. So once the throttle blade's closed, the increase in pressure in the tube gets extreme. So having enough bypass or blow-off valve is critical.
Yeah, that could get ugly in a hurry if there's nowhere for that to go. 5,000 CFM, right. Holy smoke.
Right.
Well, I'm checking one more time for any questions. I think we've covered a lot of ground today. I certainly think we've given people a good education both inside and outside the world of centrifugal blowers. Alan, you got anything left?
No, other than just bah humbug. I don't know if you can read my hat or not, but this is a special one that I had custom made just for my Christmas spirit. But looking forward to having Santa come visit in a couple of days. Looking forward to turning the calendar over and looking forward to 2021. It's been a blast doing Shop Talk. All of these things I think are very educational, Lance. Really appreciate you taking the time to walk us through some of the stuff and tell everybody about how a Vortec and a centrifugal supercharger works.
No problem. I'm happy to do it. Thank you for having me on.
So there you have it. Our Christmas gift from us to you, a little bit of education in the world of centrifugal superchargers. Thanks, Lance. Thanks, Alan. And thank you for watching Shop Talk. We'll be back after the new year. We'll continue on with Power Adders. I think we're going to take, for the next episode, instead of the blower being mounted ahead of the engine, we'll probably talk about blowers that are mounted on top of the engine. Merry Christmas. Happy New Year. We'll see you in 2021. And Rob Hedrick, the man behind the scenes, thank you as always for doing cool stuff with photos and video that we get to you at the last second. Thanks, guys.
Drag racing, a test of skill and courage.
A panorama of color and excitement.
Oh my, the incredible fire and power of NHRA drag racing.